We had this conversation that actually how can it be that planning plays such a minor role in times of this radical and global change? Should not planning, particularly in the Netherlands, play a much bigger role in informing policy, informing change, also societal change? How can it be that although planning for a long time very much institutionalized in the Netherlands has been put politically next to the garbage, in this time where we really need to look forward in order to cope with this sort of mind-boggling change that is that we need to deal with? So how can it be that this capacity for looking into the future is so much devaluated? And so that is that was the main question, and we thought it would be useful to not do this within the context of the Netherlands, but particularly seek contact with our colleagues in all over the world, but particularly in Europe, to start a process of inspire each other. And I think this is an important element in of this. This is also why we're doing this as an international series of meetings at the moment. And I think it's also very important to see the inspiration that we can get from different areas outside of the Netherlands. So basically, I think that's an important aspect. I would also today like to see if we can get some inspiration from elsewhere, perhaps also, even though you might be from the Dutch context, you would know certain examples from elsewhere, and maybe they can inspire us. Because I think it's important to mention that for today, we have this this focus. So we have done numerous subjects, you could say, within the new planning, coping with different skills, with a new national vision. We late last year did a big conference about that. We've done the peer reviews between cities, but today we would like to focus on the role and the purpose for planning in regards to a large international agreements and declarations. How do they inform our planning? How can we use them? How can we operationalize them? I think it's important to state that actually in the Netherlands we've lost a little bit of this capacity of looking ahead, planning for that. We don't have a really great track record when it comes, for instance, to the energy transition or to our natural environment, explosive livestock issues that we have, excessive mobility. Somehow we've lost our way in many of these very challenging subjects, and we need to change, and therefore it's important to see how this international declarations can play a role in it. I think it's important to maybe look back a little bit. It's interesting to note that if we look at the Paris Climate Agreement, I think by far one of the most important agreements we have currently, keeping or at least that's the goal, and the climate change and the change of temperature well below 2 degrees. Is definitely a historic agreement, and is setting a lot of things in motion at the moment. But it's important to think back maybe a little bit when this kind of declarations were very much seen as a solution to our big challenges. And that is almost 30 years ago in November 1989. When there was the first international conference on climate change in Noordwijk, in the Netherlands, ironically, actually chaired by Ed Nijpels, our current National Climate Agreement chair. I don't know how many of you read the article from a couple of years ago from the New York Times Magazine, Losing Earth, which described the whole process around actually the failing of reaching agreement at that moment. If you read that article by Nate Hill Rich, it's interesting to see that actually at that moment we thought this kind of international agreement would be able to cope with these very difficult subjects. We have just addressed at that moment quite effectively the hole in the ozone layer at that moment with banning CFKs. So why should that not work with CO2 was the idea. So basically, at that moment, 30 years ago, this agreement failed means a lot, actually, I think, today, because it makes our current work so much more pressing, but also so much more difficult. Rich blames actually human nature for not being able to reach this kind of agreement. But you can also, in this article, read very well that perhaps it's failing government that could be blamed for this. And even bad luck, I think. Wrong people at the wrong place at the wrong time. Later on, Naomi Klein reacted on this article and she actually said we should blame capitalism and particularly the neoliberal form of that and large corporations that effectively actually made sure that this kind of agreement would not be installed at that moment. So it's interesting to see, and it's also interesting to now look forward to this day and age and think about what is the role of international agreements. They need to cope with all of these different elements, how to inform government, how to inform society, how to change our economy, and we have to find ways of making them operational. And how do we do that? So I would like to point towards that subject, particularly where it goes in the field of the urban and spatial planning, and how can these kind of agreements inform this kind of effective planning agenda. So basically, that's a little bit what I would like to get out of this conversation. It's a lot, but we also have quite some time, so I'm curious what we will end up at the end of the day.